I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarlane and jazz. Check him out.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Programming is supported by UCare, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCare. Healthcare that starts with you.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. As promised, always a robust conversation. This program focuses on food, and I guess I call it food justice. How do we put our hand, our mind, our energy into solving problems in our community? The problem can be health, the problem can be jobs, employment, the problem can be access. But the spirit of this conversation is to say that we have enormous talent, enormous gifts, many assets, and we simply must continue as we are, striving to link up, hook up, and deliver strategies that are inclusive and that deliver the results we need to create the community that we desire to be. I'm pleased to have one of the great visionaries of our community, Michael Chaney. Michael Chaney is known as the leader of Project Sweetie Pie, but I've known him too as a developer of the Juneteenth Initiative and other important initiatives. Project Sweetie Pie, to me, symbolizes a entryway to understanding this whole question of food, of urban farming, of community development, of training, of job development. Michael, thank you for being here again. Let me ask you to describe the vision, the work of Project Sweetie Pie, and then I'll introduce our other guests as well.
Okay. Well, as you know, Al, and as many of your listeners out there remember, you know, 5 years ago, North High came under attack, and there were those in the community felt that its time had come and that it had to close it down. And myself and others, through a group called AfroEco, we were sitting around commiserating about the threatened closing, and we felt that the killing of a school is the killing of the heart of any community. And so in all good conscience, as an activist who, you know, spent 30, 40 years trying to make a change in my community, you know, we couldn't sit back and just watch that happen. And so we rushed forward to North High as they were talking about changing curriculum. We wanted them to look at three subject matters. We wanted them to look at culinary arts. We wanted them to look at urban farming. And we wanted them to look at food science. And so given that, they're creating three pathways, three solutions and directions for young people to work in terms of their education, job skills, job training. And so in essence, Project Sweetie Pie is really then became a, January 2010, we started growing sweet potatoes because I'd asked Rose McGee, if I could get our young people to grow sweet potatoes, would you be willing to buy them? Once I knew I had a market, then I knew that that was a positive solution, that and just instead of telling our kids, just say no to drugs, say no to gang violence, you've got to give somebody something to say yes to. And so toward that end, then went to North High, where I'd done a lot of work over the years in educational programming, and asked them. They had a green room that had been fallow there for over 10 years. And so here was this incredible resource that was there and that we weren't utilizing as a community. We didn't even know about it as a community. And so starting that, looking at that being kind of the four pillars in our community, you know, in terms of opportunity, we certainly had plenty of empty lots, right? Mm-hmm. And so why don't we, instead of waiting for somebody, you know, to deliver us from evil, why don't we as a community start gathering, start collecting all of the intellectual capital that we have, all the talent that we have? I just can't believe that, you know, that given all of the intellectual capital in this community, that North Minneapolis is this supposed, you know, dearth. And so, but what can we as a community, what can we do instead of waiting for somebody to come deliver us from evil, what we can do? So I looked at four areas. One was using the scattered gardens as kind of an awareness campaign, because someone had told me youth didn't want to get in the dirt. And that youth, i.e., which we knew, you know, urban youth is really code for African American.
Black kids.
Yeah. And so that they didn't want to get in the dirt. But given our history in agriculture, you know, I dared to beg different. And so had to go back to some old school brothers, you know, from Texas in their 60s and their 70s. And so we started doing gardens. Mm-hmm. But really saw that it really wasn't about just growing gardens. A lot of people see that that's what Project Sweetie Pie is about. It really is no different. It's another way of talking about the Nguza Saba. You know, how, what can we do in terms of collective wealth, collective economics, collective, you know, just a cooperative vision that I think that as African Americans that, you know, we're not into a hierarchical structure, but rather a cooperative, kind of a holistic model. And so Project Sweetie Pie is just another name for the, when I tell people, what's Project Sweetie Pie? It is, in essence, it's the Nguza Saba, in practice and in theory. And so using the scattered gardens as kind of the entry to get us a raise our awareness and grow in greens, but then moving forward to at Oak Park and a number of other projects, you know, we birthed the Youth Cafe over there, Culinary Arts Training Program, wanting to get a greenhouse, but bringing all of the villagers in the village of North Minneapolis together to really come figure out how we can use food as a methodology. You know, and doing a lot of reading now by this brother, Claude Anderson, who wrote this book called Powernomics. And this is, you know, 10, 15 years ago, but this is an incredible brother who really has laid out a plan that is really no different than what I'm talking about. And he's actually put a lot of positive things in force.
Hold the book up. Maybe they can get a shot of the cover.
Maybe hold it this way, so they might be
this
able to.
This way, it's called Powernomics. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The National Plan to Empower Black America. And in this book, he talks about, you know, his first book was called Black Labor, White Wealth, and how we as African Americans really give away our talents, give away our resources, instead of utilizing like every other ethnic community has done in this America, to pull ourselves allegedly up by the bootstraps and move forward. So this has become almost like a Bible to me in terms of really trying to organize, not only here locally in North Minneapolis, but really reaching out to folks that are in the food game across the country.
Well, and this is catching on.
I mean, this table reflects that there is resonance, right? There is a movement afoot to engage ourselves and to sort of recognize who we really are. It's not something that we're discovering that's new. It's a simple recognition of who we are and putting our abilities and our capacities to test. Let me introduce Antwon Wright. Antwon Wright is with the Wilder Foundation, right?
Wilder Foundation.
And you're running a community engagement project. Talk about that.
First off, I want to just give honor to you for not only the inside news, but Conversations with Al. I'm a big-time fan. And also, I want to give honors to Michael Chaney and Sweetie Pie. I have a personal relationship. I was the compost captain with the gardens that he had going on. So I'm from the Twin Cities Mobile Market, and I like to sum the Twin Cities Mobile Market up in the three words: affordable, convenient, and fresh. And basically what it is a grocery store on wheels, a revamped city bus. And we bring these resources to what I like to point out, three different individuals, the seniors, the vulnerable adults, and the disabled Minneapolis people. one of the things I like to talk about when I talk about the mobile market is the complications of getting food for these three individuals. I always bring up this story about this guy in a wheelchair. He told me that he was in the cove for like 20 minutes until somebody actually pulled over and helped him out of the snow. And he was just trying to get food. And he was on his way to a bus stop. Another one is spending $30 just to spend $20 at the grocery store, you know, cab ride to the store, 15 bucks, cab ride back. And I thought it was outrageous. So when I hooked up with the Twin Cities Mobile Market, I just thought that this was like an awesome program to bring to North Minneapolis. And fortunately, I'm figuring out the locations in North Minneapolis for the Twin Cities Mobile Market. And I just think that the people who really need it is going to get these resources.
This is the idea is that you bring fresh food.
Yes.
Affordable food.
Affordable, convenient, and fresh.
Great, great. Vanan. Vanan.
Yeah,
Vanan. Vanan. I'll say your last name. Vanan Murugesan.
Okay.
But you prefer to be called Vanan. So Vanan, you know, Pillsbury United is one of the legacy institutions in our community, and you're in this business as well. What's the vision for your work to promote food justice, food for our community?
Okay. So as some of you may know, Pillsbury United Communities is planning to open up a grocery store in North Minneapolis. It's called, right now it's called North Market. But that's just a working title that may change down the road. It's scheduled to be open in 2017. And, you know, a lot of the work that we are trying to do at Pillsbury is very similar to what Antwon is doing. I think we all know here that there's about 67,000 residents in North Minneapolis. It's only served by one full-size grocery store, which is Cub Foods. And then we have, you know, Aldi's and Solo. After that, it's a whole bunch of convenience stores, right? And as Antwon pointed out, someone has to spend about $30 to get $20 worth of food, which is a tax on the community, an unfortunate tax, right? And so what we are doing is we are bringing a full-scale solution, social enterprise solution to North Minneapolis. Now, what I would like to stress also is that North Market is actually more than just a grocery store. That's actually one of our main tagline. Everyone keeps talking about it being a grocery store, but it's actually much, much more than that. It is it's a purposeful integration of three core services. So the first thing is affordable, nutritious food. And the second thing is healthcare services. And the third would be community education. And I want to stress the word, the phrase purposeful integration, or kind of like intertwining. You could go to Cub right now, you could go to Target or any grocery stores, and you could see some of these services already existing, but they are very siloed. You go to a clinic, you come out, you're pretty much on your own, and all those things. What North Market, what Pillsbury is trying to do with North Market is this intertwining where someone who has issue with diabetes goes to the clinic. The doctor says, yes, you have diabetes, and you know what, you need to watch your diet, and this is some of the medication that you could have access to. Pharmacy is literally 20 feet away. Mm-hmm. Get some medication. There's a dietitian next door, which will walk through with this customer to figure out some of the things that this person should be eating now with their diet, right, mm-hmm. issues. And if they have issues about, oh, I don't know how to cook this, or I've never really tried these types of recipes, I mean, Appetite for Change is doing a great job introducing wonderful, culturally relevant recipes that people here can eat, know it's healthy, but also enjoy. Mm-hmm. Those are the things that we want to also have in our store. So it's pretty much an all-in-one solution.
Is your strategy to reach consumers as simple customers or members?
Yes.
Is it members?
Well, we're working through them. It's not an exclusive space. We're all going to shop there.
Right.
We could go there for just to get a milk.
Okay.
But if there's a family there who is very interested in improving their health.
How do you get people to recognize this integrated resource that you're presenting?
Uh-huh.
Because that's a model that doesn't really exist.
Correct.
People are familiar with what you described as if you go to Cub Pharmacy, you do that and you leave, or if you go to Target Pharmacy or to Target Minute Clinic or whatever, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't have what you've just described to me anywhere.
Correct.
So how do you create both awareness and build that kind of market in our community?
Correct.
Is that a fair question to you?
Oh, no, it's a fair question, and it's one that actually we are grappling right now. And To be fair, it's probably new in Minneapolis. Mm-hmm. We have similar models in, there's one in Boston out there, and there are models out there around the country, but it is a new model. Mm-hmm. So it is something I would say exciting and refreshing, but I think it's, from Pillsbury's standpoint, it is one way to provide overall improvement to a family or an individual or the community that wants these kind of services. Now, we have about a year and a half before we open the store, and our goal is actually to do heavy community engagement between now and then, and actually we are partnering with Twin Cities Mobile Market, and the idea is for us to learn what works best for the community, tailor the services based on what their needs, and when we do that, they are helping us develop these services, mm-hmm. and they will at the very end also learn about them. So we are hoping that with that kind of activities for about a year and a half, there is sufficient word of mouth to say this model exists, it works, because we have provided input into it, and then hope that will take off.
You also, let's see, what's the question I have? How will you market this? What do you do to, you said word of mouth, what's your strategy to get the buy-in by the public? What do you think?
From the North Minneapolis public?
From your customer service area.
Okay.
Yeah.
So right now we, I think we also have to acknowledge that Pillsbury is not in the grocery business, right? We do great work, but this is something very new. And this is, at the end of the day, is a business. It's a social enterprise, and we have responsibilities to meet our financial obligations. We are working very closely with Super Value, who is in the grocery business, not just as from a wholesaler, but from an operational standpoint, how to speak to your customers and how to advertise. We are working with Pillsbury United Communities has, we won about, it's called the Good Works Program. It's General Mills pro bono marketing. So for 6 to 8 months, we have basically General Mills marketing team to help us develop this message. But like I said, I think we are going to, the community engagement is actually, if you want to go from a business standpoint, that's what customer research is all about. Mm-hmm. We learn about what they need, they learn about what we can provide, and at the end of the day, we are providing something that they have essentially formed.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guests today include, you just heard, Vanan, at Pillsbury United. A wonderful project, opening up a new grocery store in North Minneapolis. We'll talk more about that in a minute. Also, Antwon Wright with the mobile market.
Twin Cities Mobile.
Twin Cities Mobile Market, and Michael Chaney, we open with him. When we come back from the break, I'm going to introduce you to the leader, the manager of the West Broadway Farmers Market, DeVon Nolen. Stay tuned. McFarlane, welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. DeVon Nolen is the manager of the West Broadway Farmers Market. DeVon, welcome to the program. I've watched the farmers market develop over the past several years. Tell me about it. Where is it now? How did it get started? And what's your vision for its growth?
Sure. Well, the West Broadway Farmers Market, we just celebrated our fifth anniversary this year, which is, we're still in the infancy stages, but I think it's a telltale sign that the community, in fact, wants a farmers market. Our farmers market is held right on West Broadway and between Emerson and DuPont. So the vacant, the lot there at U.S. Bank, we essentially take over part of that lot and put a small farmers market there on Fridays. And so in this last year, we recognized a lot of growth. We had 12,000 customers come through the farmers market. And so I think it is, again, at this tipping point where we're figuring out what's next, because we've kind of outgrown the space there and are recognizing that there's a need for a permanent space. And so there are a couple of different projects that we run through the market. One that I'm most proud of right now is called Northside Fresh Bucks. And it's a partnership with North Point. So like you mentioned earlier, Ms. Stella is very supportive of the work that we're doing. And the way it works, it's a fruit and vegetable prescription program. So patients who are North Point patients have certain BMI, have to be diabetic, can get a prescription from their doctors to come to the farmers market to buy produce.
Let me tell you this before you go on. Mm-hmm. Just in a previous program, talked about a guy I interviewed some years ago, Dr. Myers was his name. He was a physician out of Chicago that moved down to Mississippi to a neighborhood that hadn't had a doctor, a black physician. And when he opened his practice up and started seeing patients in short order, he said, what these patients need is food. He prescribed food, you know, and the county was resistant to the idea of a medical officer saying the solution to this health problem is food, yes, nutrition. And so it's wonderful that you're doing,
yes,
that.
Well,
that's
food
great.
Was our first medicine,
absolutely,
right?
Absolutely.
So when you think about, you know, being able to use food, because what we're seeing, and you know this, we have a high concentration of diet-related conditions, things that are actually curable with food. And I'll give my full disclaimer, I'm not a doctor or a dietitian or nutritionist. I'm just someone who's really passionate about this and have done quite a bit of research. And so one of my favorite visions at the farmer's market is seeing these patients who we know aren't well physically, because they have this diagnosis, dragging bags of produce, literally needing help to the car, mm-hmm, because they have so much produce. Mm-hmm. And they're consuming it. They're learning alternative ways to, you know, healthier ways to prepare it. And there's this wonderful sense of community that has been built. And I think that is one of the residuals that we see. We have a tremendous lack of public space in North Minneapolis. And we know that this disconnectedness is, in fact, also makes us sick. And so what you see happens at the farmer's market, everyone is welcome there. And so there's this, people look forward to it, is a wonderful thing.
The energy is infectious. I mean, the vibe is just welcoming and exciting. And you can tell, I mean, this sense and spirit of community is just overflowing there. Mm-hmm. So I give you that, it's just a great thing, yeah.
Thank you. And so I've only been managing the market 2 years now. And one of the things that I would say I brought in my role there is to really be able to use culture as a resource, mm-hmm, understanding that we focus a lot on our differences, but through culture we can really, really begin to raise up our commonalities. Mm-hmm. And so I begin to implement rituals at the market. We would open each market with a drum call as a sign to the community that the market is starting. Mm-hmm. And we would close each market with a line dance, mm-hmm, as a symbol of our interconnectedness. So even though the market is ending, we're still connected to one another, and I'll see you next week. And so it has been, you know, just a pleasure for me to do this work. A new project that we piloted this season, we called it Setting the Table. And so the University of Minnesota Cura gave us some small grant to run the program. And essentially what it is, Al, we hosted pay what you can meals at the market. And so it wasn't free, but we didn't turn anyone away. And all these magical things happened. We partnered with different faith communities, and we prepared the meals together. And the majority of the meal was actually sourced from Northside growers. And so it was an opportunity for us to break bread together, to like sit down, slow down and eat, mm-hmm, and not always be on the go. At the farmer's market outside in the public setting. But then we were able to, the way I frame it, is really begin to reintroduce people's palates to raw foods. A lot of the research is out there saying that we have actually built an aversion to it. Our body no longer recognizes raw foods. We don't have the right enzymes in our bellies to process it. So yeah, when I eat a carrot, I might get a stomach ache. Mm-hmm. But if you eat more carrots, your body will begin to recognize that again. And so these magical things happened. And there, I'll tell you a story about a young lady who came. She must have been with a friend, family, and she asked the father, why are we here when we can afford to buy food? And so he asked me to come over and answer her question. And I said to her, I said, because what happens here is you get to engage with people in the community that you otherwise would never meet. You see them in the passing, they might look scary to you, it's unfamiliar, right? And so in this space, you're able to sit with those very same people and have a healthy meal. And my goal in the meal was that at least half of it was raw, you know, carrots and foods that were gonna, kale. Mm-hmm. Another story, we had offered a kale salad, and this gentleman came and tested the kale salad, and minutes later he brought his brother back. And man, you gotta try this kale salad. And this is an average Joe, the guy you would see, you know, on the corner, you might be afraid of him, but he wanted kale salad in that moment. And when we had to tell him there was no more kale salad, he didn't really like that. But we were able to offer him a recipe and say, here's where you can buy more and prepare it on your own. So a lot of my work, Al, is really just dispelling the myth that poor people don't want to eat healthy, because that's not true. You know, we know what we're dealing with the concentration of poverty here. We understand, you know, how that impacts our health and our life expectancy, but there's so much hope. And I think we need to be more intentional about talking about the hope and even challenging the language around disparities.
Well, one of the things that I stuck in my head was when I interviewed, either heard him or I was interviewing him, Michael Chaney here, and he just grabbed my mind and took me somewhere else. You know, he said he viewed Plymouth Avenue as the Nile of North Minneapolis, and just the image of that and just popped in my mind, and I can't get it out because I know what the Nile symbolizes.
Yes.
As a source of life in Africa, and I know the comedic, the African black consciousness elements of this notion of the Nile as a source of life and the giver of life and its connection to all things. And so to begin to recast, reimagine our community, its potential, and this place, this lion, as a life force resource through gardening, urban farming, was a powerful image. And what you're saying is that we have to sort of change the dialogue.
Absolutely.
Change the narrative.
Absolutely.
And to create a vocabulary mm-hmm. in our community that allows us to articulate, to see, and to move on strategies that empower and enrich us as individuals and as communities. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
And so talk about that. You take off from there, Vanan.
Yeah.
You're nodding in approval. So what am I saying to you?
No, I think it's pretty obvious to everyone here in this room that I'm not from North Minneapolis. Mm-hmm. But the reason why I'm really excited about this, the work that we at Pillsbury is about to do and the one I'm involved in, is because the solutions are out there, you know, and unfortunately for a variety of reasons, disparities, or just from historical perspective, the North Minneapolis residents have not been able to appreciate the benefits. But the work that all of us are doing here, the work that, you know, I have to say that these guys are doing the work right now. We are about to do the work, but it inspires me to see that it is actually successful. I'm from Malaysia. I moved to the United States in 97. I moved to Minneapolis in 2006. Mm-hmm. I regularly come to North Minneapolis since 2013. Mm-hmm. So this is all very new to me, right? I just have the good heart, so to speak. Mm-hmm. But when you're doing the work and you see what's possible by the work that's being done here, it's more than just hope. It's just you do the work, it will actually happen. That's what it is. And from our standpoint, North Market, it's a business. So what we're trying to do is, it has to be self-sustaining. Mm-hmm. Our goal is to, yes, there will be some initial fundraising, but at the end of the day, the business is going to run this. The community is going to fund the very services that they will benefit from. And I just see this changing the narrative, mm-hmm. where if I live in St. Louis Park, I have great friends, mm-hmm. and they're not racist, so to speak, but they have this narrative for whatever reason about North Minneapolis, right? And I had them too. Mm-hmm. But I'm working in an area and I'm seeing people who are actually changing that story. And we want, you know, we are partnering with North. I actually work with Princess for community engagement. Like, we are working together to change this narrative. Mm-hmm. And I think there is enough, you know, assets, there's enough capital, there's enough dollars. We've done market analysis.
Yeah, money's here.
Yep, the money's here. People are just spending it elsewhere, which is a tragic, right?
Yeah.
But the story's like, there's no money in North Minneapolis. Give me a break.
Not true.
Yep, so what we're doing is that spend your money here. Right. Spend your money on something that you help design, you help develop, mm-hmm. and it speaks to you.
Mm-hmm. Well, I want to go beyond just the spending the money. Mm-hmm. Here, I want to go to beyond. Let's keep the money here. That's really been for me the real pitfall is that we as residents, as taxpayers, that, you know, again, we're always black bodies building white wealth, and because we have not had the capital to create our institutions. What I like about the fact now is that we actually have a supply line now, and we can actually but. I'm cautious that if we, as Wilder, as Pillsbury, that if you going beyond the engagement of just telling people and giving them another opportunity to be yet another consumer,
through another institution, I think that the real bond and the real hope here is that here is an opportunity not just to have black shoppers in another institutional place, but to really invite them in to partake and share in the wealth building. Mm-hmm. You know, because if we're growing the food, here we have they talk about the food system. Here we have an opportunity for young African-American kids, Asian kids, white kids growing in the school system. There's $5 million that through the Farm to School Initiative. And that if all we get out of that is yet another carrot or a piece of lettuce, then we've been shortchanged and hoodwinked once again. Here is an opportunity through the infrastructure that we are all building and creating. Here's an opportunity for me not just to be able to come and spend my money at your store. And I will do that happily. If there's an opportunity through Pillsbury, if there's opportunities through Wilder, where actual residents from this community can actually be investors in that opportunity, mm-hmm. that they can grow pie like Rose McGee. We can have Rose McGee's pies on that food mart truck. We can have Rose McGee's pies on your grocery store shelves. And just like Rose McGee, who has been a successful pie maker and leader, et cetera, that there's a whole host of other residents in this community who this will provide an on-ramp where they can become not only shoppers at your store, but they become shareholders in your store, shareholders in the success of your store. Because why will they come to your store? They'll come to your store versus going to Cub Foods if there's a return on their investment, if they are part of the shareholders in that success. And if we as leaders in this community, if we can create that dynamic, if we can create that vehicle, now we are like that those tugboats that's pulling that big ocean liner out to sea, because every boat rises, everybody has a reason to come to your shop, and we're not just being used. We're no longer just sharecroppers, but we're all now co-owners, co-investors mm-hmm. in the village of North Minneapolis. You know, when you go to the grocery store for your children, you don't go and buy steak for yourself and buy hamburger for your children. You go and buy food that will serve your whole family. And that's what I like about what DeVon is saying, is that we are all part of the family of man. We are all residents of the village of North Minneapolis, and we all have to share in the kill. You know, we all have to be stakeholders. We all have to be recipients of that largesse. If the money starts flowing, we don't want to get shortchanged like we've been over and over and time again, that in this food industry, in this new food movement, we have to make sure that we're getting our fair share of the pie. That's what I hope to see.
Can I add on to that?
Yeah. Go ahead, Antwon.
Al, I want to piggyback on return on your investment. And a lot of people talk about money, return on your investment. I want to talk about a different return. I'm talking about time, because I think time is more valuable than money. And I also want to touch bases on the disconnect, where there will be a connect with this Twin Cities mobile market. Okay, we have 18 locations in St. Paul. And granted, the return that I've been seeing as far as like time and the connect, where the disconnect is like, I go grocery shopping for some of the elders that can't even get out of Cheers. Say, for instance, just to fulfill one grocery order, it's kind of like overwhelming with joy because of the hope and the contentment that I see in them. Mm-hmm. And they're not worried about money. They're worried about the time. And, you know, I'm 39, but I look a little young when I shave. And they think that I'm some young guy trying to help them out with groceries. However, the return on the investment that we're bringing to the table, what Michael is talking about, is simply time. And when you do something for a senior that really doesn't have that much attention, it brings about hope. And there's a certain contentment that's there that they understand that we're actually doing something for them. So along with the monies that will be kept in the community, I just want to bring about that acknowledgement of youth versus the seniors, if that makes sense.
Let me spend the last 30 seconds with Vanan, and you've got to go after this break. But you've got 30 seconds. What's the point that you wanted to make here?
I just wanted to actually echo what Michael was saying, and we completely agree with that. This, again, more than just a grocery store, this is a vehicle that the funders, the community, entrepreneurs can use to, you know, rise all together. This is a business that's owned by a nonprofit, so we get to make certain types of decisions that a traditional business would not do, would have no interest in doing it. So there is a commitment. It is there that we will have aisles dedicated to the sweet pie, the sweetie pies. Mm-hmm. There is a section that's dedicated to local farmers that you grow a ton of kale. If it makes sense for you to sell it over there, we want to provide that opportunity. Maybe I wasn't clear about it, but the commitment is there.
That's wonderful. Listen, I want to thank you for being here. You've got to leave for another appointment, but thank you so much. And we're going to continue this conversation in just a minute. I'm Al McFarland. This is Conversations with Al McFarland. We'll be back. I'm Al McFarland. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarland, a great conversation here at the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. You know, the question is food justice. I love the phrase food justice. I'm not sure if you like it or not, Michael, but I love what you do. And I think I was talking with you and Redmond, LaDonna Redmond, and Glenn at the time about food justice and what that means. I think it's so important that we have ongoing and public and principled conversations about our interest in food and in health. And I think the underpinning has to be the belief that we have both the right and the obligation to be the stewards of our community and of our destiny. And that includes economic and political and cultural systems that support and sustain our lives, our families, and that reflect our identity, the ideal that we see ourselves always evolving towards. What you're doing in helping us rethink our relationship with food is significant. I'm going to go Brother Antwon here, I'm treating you like you are a 20-year-old. You're younger than me and Michael, I know that. You told me you're 39, but I'm talking to the generation. And I remember years back, man, where I'd see young people who almost had the attitude that if they couldn't buy it in a store, they would starve. And I had this contradiction in my mind. Look, you're in the land of 10,000 lakes, mm-hmm. A fishing pole and a worm, there's food around here. And plus, you can, there's always work. There really is work here. Yes. You've got to want to do it, despite the statistics. And so I feel like a lot of our young people got misinformed, miseducated about the whole food chain process. So if they couldn't get it in the corner store, mm-hmm. already packaged, it didn't exist. Is that a fair observation on my part? How does your generation and the ones after you look at this question of food?
Absolutely. Corner stores have a big impact on my generation and younger. I see so many bag chips and cups of noodles, going on. I asked a few kids that I was gardening with Project Sweetie Pie this summer, where'd your food come from? And surprisingly, most of the answers came from grocery stores. And it probably was a trick question, at the time, but I was just trying to see if they understood that food comes from the ground and you can grow food. However, corner stores have played a big role on healthy eating, which comes out to be unhealthy eating. And to go a little further to say, is there a connection between healthy eating in dysfunctional families, I jump out there and say yes. I really want to tell you about...
Can I add to that?
Yes.
And so to your point, Al, you know, we are subject to this industrialized food system.
Yes.
That he and I watched develop. Mm-hmm. And so the generation after us were born into that. And so we are kind of that bridge to where we still have the connection with our ancestors and our elders who say, we remember having gardens at Big Mama's house. The generation after us didn't have the Big Mama's garden. Mm-hmm. And so I think the onus falls on us to create spaces where we can get their hands back in the dirt, because magical things happen then, because what we're talking about is intuitive. Mm-hmm. We are intuitively connected to mm-hmm. the earth in that way. But oftentimes no one ever asks them, right? No one, we just make a lot of assumptions. And to Antwon's point, you know, when you talk about healthy food access, the environment these conditions have been engineered. Mm-hmm. And so we're reliant on convenience stores because those are the types of grocers that are allowed to get business licenses in our city. I mean, they're structural things mm-hmm. that have created this environment. And so when I'm with the young people and talk to them about food, I've noticed that there's a shift. Like you said earlier, there's this awareness that has happened to where it's now cool, fun, and hip. It's not this taboo thing that is, you know, still so directly connected to the experience with slavery, right? Because a lot of people have that issue. They see, you know, working the land as a direct connection to what our ancestors went through. And there's some truth to that. Mm-hmm. But we're in a different place now. So where we can now use that as a catalyst and say, yes, that did happen and we experienced those things and it's in your DNA. But this is how you reconcile. This is how you honor your ancestors, by putting your hands back in the dirt. I can go on and on about that.
I want to hear more. So how did you come to this work that you're doing?
I come from a family born and raised in North Minneapolis. And now, in retrospect, I recognize that we always ate pretty healthy because we always had food growing. And I got into this work. I had a personal experience where I lost my sister to a tumor in her brain stem. And almost 6 months to the day she was diagnosed, she passed away at 15. But during those 6 months, my mother put all of her energies into trying to heal her, and really took this deep dive and kind of opened the floodgates and the Pandora's box of what has happened to our food system. That was the catalyst for me. My mother is now a naturopath, so I'm constantly inundated with good information about how to heal ourselves.
What's a naturopath?
Naturopath is alternative medicine. How you can use things that come from the earth to heal yourself. And so it's not just about a job for me. This is my lifestyle. I'm a farmer. I know how to build a hoop house. I know how to do aquaponics.
How are you a farmer? Let me ask you that.
I grow food in my backyard.
Okay.
I also work with Project Sweetie Pie.
Mm-hmm.
And I work with farmers not just outside of Minneapolis. I serve on the Homegrown Minneapolis Food Council. We are the body that helps advise the city of Minneapolis about what needs to happen with our food environment. I was instrumental in helping to drive the Minnesota Food Charter. Are you familiar with the Food Charter? It's a document that was lots of work went into developing the Food Charter, lots of community engagement to just learn about what some of the challenges are as it relates to healthy food access. But also, even beyond healthy food access, as it relates to the enterprises behind food, food preparation, food skills, things like that. And so this document was developed that is used statewide to help drive policy that will create the environment where we can have healthy food access in every part of our state.
You mentioned aquaponics.
Aquaponics, yes.
Tell me about it.
So I know a little bit. I know how to build what they live in, but it's essentially raising fish. Preferably not GMO fish, right? But raising fish, and it's a complete self-sustaining cycle where you raise the fish and the gases and whatnot that come off of that then feed the food that you grow on top. And so I've seen it be most successful with growing microgreens. And that is a hip and fun. Yes.
They are. In fact, you can go right here in North Minneapolis.
North High has one.
You can go to Ron McConnickle on Queen and 22nd, and in his front yard, he's actually built an aquaponics scale model that he created, where he's growing koi and he's growing trout, and he's got young people there who are growing it, and they're growing it and the vegetables and the fish. Mm-hmm. You know, I kind of want to return back a little bit to, you know, this is all that we have today in terms of the food system is not an accident. You know, when we talk about, you know, and belabor the fact of what our kids aren't or aren't doing, I put the burden on us as elders because we drank the Kool-Aid. We abandoned, you know, what it took 100 and 150 years for this system to undo, you know, the turn of the century. We were basically very self-reliant as human beings. We grew our own food. You know, I mean, Minnesota is the heart, is in the heartland of the breadbasket, right? And so the family farm grew your food, you know. But at the same time, around the turn of the century, as we abandoned growing our food and industrial agriculture started being born, the same thing, you know, DeVon talks about naturopath, the same thing happened there, that no longer were we became specialized, that don't worry about growing your food, we got this. Don't worry about your medicine, we got this. And so we know, just as everything else, that if you give your power away, then there's abuse of power. So we've been socially engineered, as it were, where we've seen, you know, the proliferation of fast food, because if you grow the food, you know the food, you are your own doctor. And so that's clearly, for me, in retracing history, as a fan of history, realizing that we drank the Kool-Aid, we gave away the farm, and that I like to tell people, do I grow? Of course I do. I manage kids every summer. We got, you know, 20-some garden plots. But I see myself more as an egg patriot, because for me, the heart and soul of everything that we do is, do you believe in the American dream or don't you? If you believe in the American dream, that it's incumbent that every resident, from large to small, is actively engaged in every aspect of that dream, of the American dream. If they're not, if we haven't engaged them and we've allowed other people to box out residents, our community is not on the playing field. We've been boxed out of the free enterprise system. Yep. And marginalized, and so it's our job, it's incumbent on us that we get every young woman, man, woman, child, that we get them off of the bench, we get them out on the playing field, and we give them opportunities to grow a life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And that's our challenge as free-loving Americans, as people who believe in the American dream, that everybody should have access.
Antwon, what did you want to add? Yes.
I just wanted to add the connection of relationship. Mm-hmm. Of what I do, but I love what she said, because we've been snatched away from growing our own foods. I really don't have anything to say anything more to add to what she was saying. I just wanted to, like, explain the relationship-wise of what I do, because I think it comes along with healthy eating, and we restore that relationship. just doing things for people who can't, from physical disabilities, from eating unhealthy. Mm-hmm. I hate to use the word obese, but there's obesity in the community. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when you get to an age where you can't exercise and it's already, like, too late, the relationship that you have with at least delivering the healthy food to, I guess, prolong the situation, I hate to say it like that, but it's a relationship that brings about hope. Mm-hmm. And I guess that's the bridge of,
let me tell you what I'm hearing. I'm hearing
you describe something about the value of service,
exactly.
The value of supporting life. I hear you saying something about the beauty of exploring and acting on the possibility of extending life and extending life with quality.
Yes.
And I hear you talking about not condemning actions that have led to various levels of ability, disability conditions, but delivering the solution for today. But the delivery itself is an act of compassion, an act of consciousness, and an act of service.
Actually,
that's what I hear.
Yes, yes. And to add to that, awareness. Okay, if this is happening now, will we continue this? If we're fixing it now, let's not continue it. Let's actually eat healthy. So thank you for that.
You know, we like to say in Project Supervise, we're growing good in the neighborhood. Good food, good schools, good youth and families. So it's really about creating, as DeVon said, a healthy community with a healthy lifestyle.
To Antwon's point, if I could add to that, when you talk about social cohesion and how that impacts our health, there are large populations that are isolated. And you know, our lifestyle now, because we have technology and we just don't interact the way we used to. And so there are, you know, populations, like I said, of elders and young people as well who are isolated, and you know, what the impacts of that are on our health. And so the vision, I work with Elder Chaney, and I have been for years now, and I'm telling you, he's the visionary. He's got the vision. It's there. It's laid out. It's on that little sheet of paper right there. But the question is, how do we, and I hear him say this often, how do we get ourselves to the point where we are producers? We're not just consumers. So that when we talk about, you know, economic vitality, we have to, you know, find ways, and my organization actually does it, to support this really strong entrepreneurial spirit we have in North Minneapolis. I mean, it's great if you can get a job and you know, take care of your family, but how much greater is it if you can have something, you can create a legacy and you have something to pass down to your family?
Just do a job and a business.
Exactly.
Do them both.
And that's I think that's where we are.
And that's how you do it, yeah.
And so just as an example, we're running a holiday boutique in downtown Minneapolis in the RBC Plaza. Mm-hmm. Extremely successful. These are all Northsiders who are bringing their talents downtown. Mm-hmm. And now we're reaching a population of people that have disposable income. Mm-hmm. Because there's a huge economic gap between North Loop and North Minneapolis, right, which are walking distance. There's a $70,000 income difference there. Mm-hmm. And that has a huge impact on people's quality of life and how they access food and if they exercise and all those things that, you know, poverty makes you sick, but poverty is created. So I'll stop talking because I can go on about that.
There's opportunity for crime prevention in all of this. Mm-hmm. And we're putting that together right now, me and my wife. Mm-hmm. And that's another conversation with Al.
It means it's all connected. Nothing's
separated, right? It's all the same thing. If you do one, you got to do them all, or you're not doing anything. But at the same time, you stay in your lane, do what you do best, right?
Yes.
But understand the connection. So, Michael, we got about a minute left. I want to close with you. Again, the vision. Talk about the vision. When you see our neighborhood, our community, our North Minneapolis, reborn and flourishing, describe this community. What's in your mind's eye?
Well, I don't know if I'd use the word reborn. I mean, I think that we have pockets of vision, and no community, no people are ever short of great ideas. Mm-hmm. What they may be short of is access to capital to bring some of those good ideas to life. So I'm really excited by the fact of Antwon and the farmer's market and the grocery store, because that's the supply line. So instead of us just earning money and it being cast out across the far and wide, we're able to retain some of that economics in our community, and with that will come economic growth. You know, this brother here, again, I bring Claude Anderson, you know, the Bible, you know, I mean, he talks in this thing about farmers market and the food industry, and for me, food is, you know, I call it the full meal deal. I mean, here we have a chance now to have young people growing the food, working at Pillsbury United, Oak Park, and a few appetite for change, learning how to prepare that food, and then taking that food one step further and putting a label. DeVon and I, we were all members of Northside Fresh from North Point, and we're revisiting that. And so, you know, as one brother used to tell me, he says, all I see is hip, hip, and happy days. So, you know, I'm an eternal optimist.
There you go. Listen, thank you for the conversation. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My thanks to Michael Chaney of Project Sweetie Pie, to DeVon Nolen of the West Broadway Farmers Market, and to Antwon Wright, who's with the Twin Cities market on a bus?
Mobile market.
Mobile market, okay, thank you. Listen, guys, thank you so much. Keep doing what you're doing. Thank you so much. And join us again next time. I'm Al McFarlane. Bye-bye.
Programming is supported by UCARE, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCARE, healthcare that starts with you.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say goodnight. We want to thank Al McFarlane for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning, right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation. Because this thing is safe. The message is clear. Everybody knows we got to keep it light. Yeah.